The computation, like calendars, paid no attention to possible changes in water vapor and clouds, and overall was too crude to convince scientists. It is almost certain, one authority scolded, that these figures will be subject to many strong revisions. 27. Yet Plass had proved one central point: it was a mistake to dismiss the greenhouse effect with spectroscopic arguments. He warned that climate change could be a serious problem to future generations, although not for several centuries. Following the usual pattern, Plass was mainly interested in the way variations in CO2 might solve the mystery of the ice ages. If at the end of this century the average temperature has continued to rise, he wrote, then it would be firmly established that CO2 could cause climate change. People who read science notes in the back pages of the New York Times would find a leading physicist confirming that it may take 30 or 40 years to find out how CO2 would affect planet's energy balance. 28. Revel's result. Government. None of this work met the argument that the oceans would promptly absorb nearly all the CO2 humanity might emit. Plass had estimated that gas added to the atmosphere would stay there for 1,000 years. Equally plausible estimates suggested that the surface waters of the oceans would absorb it in a matter of days. 29. Fortunately, scientists could now track the movements of carbon with a new tool, the radioactive isotope carbon-14. This radioactive isotope was produced abundantly in the fallout from nuclear weapon tests during the 1950s. Sensitive instruments could detect even a tiny amount carried thousands of miles on the world's winds, and the data provided the first comprehensive mapping of the global circulation of air. The results confirmed what had only been guessed: within a few years any addition of CO2 was well mixed throughout the atmosphere, from pole to pole and from the surface into the highest stratosphere. 29a. Carbon-14 is also created by cosmic rays in the upper atmosphere and then decays over millennia. The carbon in ancient coal and oil is so old that it entirely lacks the radioactive isotope. Therefore, emissions from burning fossil fuels would add only plain carbon to the atmosphere. In 1955, the chemist Hans Suess reported an analysis of wood from trees grown over the past century, finding that the newer the wood, the higher its ratio of plain carbon to carbon-14. He had detected an increase of fossil carbon in the atmosphere. External input. Carbon dates. The amount of fossil carbon that Suess saw added to the atmosphere was barely 1%, a fraction so low that he concluded that the oceans were indeed taking up most of the carbon that came from burning fossil fuels. A decade would pass before he reported more accurate studies, which showed a far higher fraction of fossil carbon. Yet already in 1955 it was evident that Suess's data were preliminary and insecure. The important thing he had demonstrated was that fossil carbon really was showing up in the atmosphere. More work on carbon-14 should tell just how carbon was circulating in the planetary system. 30. Revel's result. Suess took up the problem in collaboration with Roger Revel at the Scripps Institution of Oceanography in La Jolla, California. Some other carbon-14 experts attacked the topic independently, all reaching much the same conclusions. From measurements of how much of the isotope was found in the air and how much in sea water, they calculated the movements of CO2. It turned out that the ocean surface waters took up a typical molecule of CO2 from the atmosphere within a decade or so. Measurements of the travels of radioactive carbon from bomb tests meanwhile showed that the oceans turned over completely in several hundred years, an estimate soon confirmed by evidence from other studies. 31. At first sight that seemed fast enough to sweep any extra CO2 into the depths. Revel's result. The oceans. But Revel had been studying the chemistry of the oceans through his entire career, and he knew that the seas are not just salt water but a complex stew of chemicals. These chemicals create a peculiar buffering mechanism that stabilizes the acidity of sea water. The mechanism had been known for decades, but Revel now realized that it would prevent the water from retaining all the extra CO2 it took up. A careful look showed that the surface layer could not really absorb much additional gas, barely 1/10 the amount a naive calculation would have predicted. A supplementary essay on Revel's discovery tells this crucial story in full, as a detailed example of the complex interactions often found in geophysical research. Revel did not at first recognize the full significance of his work. He made a calculation in which he assumed that industry would emit CO2 at a constant rate. Like most people at the time, he scarcely grasped how explosively population and industry were rising. This gave a prediction that the concentration in the air would level off after a few centuries, with an increase of no more than 40%. Revel did note that greenhouse effect warming may become significant during future decades if industrial fuel combustion continues to rise exponentially. He also wrote that human beings are now carrying out a large-scale geophysical experiment of a kind that could not have happened in the past nor be reproduced in the future. 32. Equals government. As sometimes happens with landmark scientific papers, written in haste while understanding just begins to dawn, Revel's explanation was hard to grasp. Other scientists failed to see the point that was obscurely buried in the calculations, and continued to deny there was a greenhouse effect problem. In 1958, when Callender published a paper to insist once again that CO2 observations showed a steady rise from the 19th century, he noted Revel's paper but still confessed that he did not understand why the oceans have not been accepting additional CO2 on anything like the accepted scale. 33. Finally, in 1959, two meteorologists in Sweden, Bert Bolin and Erik Eriksson, caught on. They explained the sea water buffering clearly, so clearly that during the next few years, some scientists cited Bolin and Eriksson's paper for this decisive insight rather than Revel and Sousa's. Only in later years was Revel always cited for the discovery. 34. The central insight was that although sea water did rapidly absorb CO2, most of the added gas would promptly evaporate back into the air before the slow oceanic circulation swept it into the abyss. To be sure, the chemistry of air and sea water would eventually reach an equilibrium, but that could take thousands of years. Arrhenius had not concerned himself with timescales shorter than that, but geoscientists in the 1950s did. Keeling's curve. In the late 1950s, a few American scientists, starting with Plass, tentatively began to inform the public that greenhouse gases might become a problem within the foreseeable future. Revel in particular warned journalists and government officials that greenhouse warming deserved serious attention. The stakes were revealed when Bolin and Eriksson pursued the consequences of their calculation to the end. They assumed industrial production would climb exponentially, and figured that atmospheric CO2 would rise some 25% by the year 2000. That was a far swifter rise than anyone before had suggested. As the New York Times reported in a brief note, Bolin suggested that the effect on climate might be radical. 34a, in 1962, a still stronger, although also little heeded, warning was sounded by the Russian climate expert Mikhail Budaiko. His calculations of the exponential growth of industrial civilization suggested a drastic global warming within the next century or so. Once meteorologists understood that ocean uptake was slow, they found it possible that CO2 levels had been rising, just as Callender insisted. 35, yet it was only a possibility, for the measurements were all dubious. By the mid-1950s, researchers were saying that it was important to measure, much more accurately, the concentration of CO2 in the atmosphere. 36, a Scandinavian group accordingly set up a network of 15 measuring stations in their countries. Their only finding, however, was a high noise level. Their measurements apparently fluctuated from day to day as different air masses passed through, with differences between stations as high as a factor of 2. Only much later was it recognized that their methods of analyzing the air had been inadequate, and responsible for much of the noise. 37, a leading authority summarized the scientific opinion of the late 1950s, it seems almost hopeless to arrive at reliable estimates of CO2, by such measurements in limited areas. To find if the gas level was changing, measurements would have to be made concurrently and during a great number of years at many locations. 38. Charles David, Dave, Keeling held a different view. As he pursued local measurements of the gas in California, he saw that it might be possible to hunt down and remove the sources of noise. Technical advances in infrared instrumentation allowed an order of magnitude improvement over previous techniques for measuring gases like CO2. Taking advantage of that, however, would require many costly and exceedingly meticulous measurements, carried out someplace far from disturbances. Most scientists, looking at the large and apparently unavoidable fluctuations in the raw data, thought such precision irrelevant and the instrumentation too expensive. But Revel and Seuss happened to have enough funds to hire Keeling to measure CO2 with precision. Keeling's funds. A supplementary essay tells the precarious story of Keeling's funding and monitoring of CO2 levels as a detailed example of how essential research and measurements might be fed or starved. Revel's simple aim was to establish a baseline snapshot of CO2 values around the world, averaging over the large variations he expected to see from place to place and from time to time. After a couple of decades, somebody could come back, take another snapshot, and see if the average CO2 concentration had risen. Keeling did much better than that with his new instruments. With painstaking series of measurements in the pristine air of Antarctica and high atop the Mauna Loa volcano in Hawaii, he nailed down precisely a stable baseline level of CO2 in the atmosphere. In 1960, with only 2 full years of Antarctic data in hand, Keeling reported that this baseline level had risen. The rate of the rise was approximately what would be expected if the oceans were not swallowing up most industrial emissions, 39. Lack of funds soon closed down the Antarctic station, but Keeling managed to keep the Mauna Loa measurements going with only a short hiatus. As the CO2 record extended, it became increasingly impressive, each year noticeably higher. Soon Keeling's curve, jagged but inexorably rising, was widely cited by scientific review panels and science journalists, 40, for both scientists and the public it became the primary icon of the greenhouse effect. Keeling understood immediately that the curve is jagged because plants in the northern hemisphere take up CO2 as they grow in spring and summer, and release it as they decay in autumn and winter. Carbon dioxide, key to climate change? 1960s to 1970s. Keeling's funds. Keeling's curve. New carbon-14 measurements were giving scientists solid data to chew on. Researchers began to work out just how carbon moves through its many forms in the air, ocean, minerals, soils, and living creatures. They plugged their data into simple models, with boxes representing each reservoir of carbon, ocean surface waters, plants, etc., and arrows showing the exchanges of CO2 among the reservoirs. The final goal of most researchers was to figure out how much of the CO2 produced from fossil fuels was sinking into the oceans, or perhaps was being absorbed by vegetation, see above. But along the way there were many curious puzzles, which forced researchers to make inquiries among experts in far distant fields. Biosphere. During the 1960s, these tentative contacts among almost entirely separate research communities developed into ongoing interchanges. Scientists who studied biological cycles of elements such as nitrogen and carbon, typically supported by forestry and agriculture interests, got in touch with, among others, geochemists, typically in academic retreats like the Scripps Institution of Oceanography in La Jolla, California. This emerging carbon cycle community began to talk with atmospheric scientists who pursued interests in weather prediction, typically at government-funded laboratories like the National Center for Atmospheric Research in Boulder, Colorado, or the Geophysical Fluid Dynamics Laboratory in Princeton, New Jersey. One valuable example of this crossover of interests was a calculation published by Princeton computer specialists in 1967. They had managed to produce a model that simulated something roughly like the actual climate of the planet, with deserts and sea ice and trade winds in all the right places. Out of curiosity, they doubled the amount of CO2 in their simulated atmosphere. The simulated global temperature rose a couple of degrees, 41.